That's
moving on. Last week was Microsoft's Build conference, which is a developers conference, and they talk everything about, you know, Windows and their platform with PCs and whatnot. But in recent years, they've also been talking about Xbox, the Xbox division in that conference, which is interesting. And Phil is there, Phil Spencer, the head of Xbox, and all of the team behind.
Love you, Phil.
Yeah, I love Phil. You're great, buddy. Check the show. Give us a call sometime. And some interesting, very interesting topics were touched upon on that conference, and I wanted to touch on some of them. Some important ones, obviously nothing Windows related because this is a gaming podcast, but in terms of gaming, some very interesting things were talked about, not necessarily in the conference, some of them were, but not all in the conference, but afterwards on a real press conference with a Q&A going on and, you know, people asking Phil about things. And yes, first off, Halo 5. Halo 5, it's a very good game. You guys know I love it. A lot of people have been, you know, saying that because of their recent route and path with PC and, you know, how they're bringing everything to PC, they wanted to see Halo in PC. And he answered around that. He answered about Halo in PC. He said Halo 5 is not likely going to be coming to PC. He wants to look forward into the future in terms of Halo games. So he says, okay, we're not close to it for future installments of a Halo game. But I have a quote right here. Let me read it and you can hear it for yourselves. In terms of Halo 5 first-person shooters on PC, I think there's a ton of opportunity for us right now, but I don't want to get into a world where we look back like at Halo 5. It doesn't mean there's nothing that could ever end up on PC, but I much rather look forward with what our plans are. So moving on, like looking into the future, right? He also points out that I don't want to make it some kind of artificial mandate, because then I think we'd end up with a Franken game, games that really weren't meant for a certain platform. And because some suit said, hey, everything's got to run on both platforms, you end up with something that people don't want. And I think he has a point in there. I don't necessarily, if they do a hybrid with Halo and PC and Xbox, they would do a disservice to the console players because, yeah, again, first-person shooters in PC is a very different beast, a very different type of game, much more accurate, much more fast-paced, different in every sense. And a game like Halo, I don't think would lend itself to be played on PC like, you know, the way it's meant to be played. And on that, I do think that, you know, if people want Halo going to PC, they have a lot of different franchises that are not necessarily first-person shooters, things like Halo Wars, which is a strategy game, a real-time strategy game, which is perfect for a PC environment. Halo, you know, the Halo Spartan Assault games, the top-down shooters, which were relatively good. I didn't play them. But yeah, those kind of games, I think, would make a good appearance on PC. And if, you know, they want to bring a first-person shooter to PC, it's got to be a first-person shooter that is natively thought out to be made and played on PC. Not necessarily the main installment, not Halo 6 or 7. I think if they want something in PC for Halo, they should make an entirely new game that's just thought out from the beginning to be a PC game.
Man, that's too much information, really. But, like, basically, that boils down to the initial summary that you said, like, we're not close to it, but not now, definitely. And I think that it's smart, in my opinion, to not bring Halo 5 right now to PC, because I mean, you wanna merge both platforms in one way or another, because I mean, it's Windows, it's Microsoft, right? But in a sense, I mean, you gotta keep this thing alive, right? You gotta keep exclusives,
right?
At least some exclusives on the Xbox. And Halo is still the biggest name on Xbox. And I do think that you got to keep that on your
platform. It's an exclusive, yeah.
Yeah, I do not think it's a good idea to ever bring a new installment of Halo to PC. I don't think so. Maybe a different title, a different Halo title to PC. Yeah, for instance, Halo Wars, I think it's a game that fits a lot better on the PC landscape. But I mean, Halo traditionally has been this console experience, this LAN console experience with your buddies with, yes, and frozen pizza and whatever, just staying up at night and just shooting the hell out of each other. And,
yes.
And that's also my gripe with Halo 5, with why they removed the split screen. Yeah. Yeah. And I think it's... You gotta keep that on Xbox. I think so.
Me too.
And I think Phil Spencer's answer to that is more of like a general PR thing that just to
appease the people,
yeah, and keep the doors open for anything they decide to do in the future.
Right. So yeah. Yeah, we were actually talking about that a month back, I think, where we said that, yeah, we don't really understand. And I personally don't really like Microsoft's strategy with this hybrid with PC and, you know, really going that strong with PC in mind. I mean, I don't think it's necessarily a bad thing. I don't think it's necessarily the wrong way to go. But I personally don't like it because they're taking the value away from the box. And ultimately, that's going to hurt the Xbox division in a way. Which is a good segue for our next topic, which is that they announced, and I actually said it, and now I stand corrected. I said that the Forza games were never going to be brought to PC. Well, every Forza game from now on is going to be on both PC and Xbox. So, yeah.
I mean, I being completely honest, I feel very unsure of this decision. Like, it doesn't bother me. It doesn't affect me because, as I've said before, I don't care about PC gaming really, so it doesn't bother me in any way as a possible future Xbox One owner, right? But I don't know. Like, I think it takes away a lot of the magic of the console.
Yes.
Like, to have your flagship racing series not exclusive anymore. I don't know. Like, for instance, imagine Nintendo doing that. I mean, now, and there's a new F-Zero game coming out, and it's coming also for PC. Like, man, like, I don't know.
Yeah, no one's going to buy it now.
Yeah, it takes away a lot of the excitement, I think, for the brand, for the Xbox brand, yes, right? Having that on PC, and I don't know, like, I guess you want to sell more copies, right? I get that, but I don't know. Who knows?
I know. I mean, on the flip side, you know, unlike first-person shooters, I think that Forza, a game like Forza, a racing game, makes more sense in terms of, okay, games that you want to bring to PC, to Microsoft, to Windows.
Yeah.
It makes more sense because there's, you know, now you can make a hybrid. You can now make a shared network where PC players can interact with console players and back and forth, and,
right,
you know, the other way around.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it makes more sense in terms of, okay, games that you can bring. I still am very unsure about the strategy and the route. If they want to go that way, they probably made some studies that show that probably it's a good idea to go. Definitely. I personally don't like it. I don't understand it, but I'm not an expert either. So, I don't know. Let's wait and see. But, yeah, I think it's a very thin line they're walking through. And they ought to be careful with
that. Yeah. It doesn't bother me, but I don't know. I feel like it may hurt the Xbox brand in the long term, and I don't know. I don't like that very much.
Yeah, I mean, honest. I'm not even a racing game kind of guy, so it doesn't really affect me.
Yeah, you haven't even played any Forza game, right?
I played Forza 5, but I played it. I don't own it. Okay. I just tried it out at a friend's house, I think.
Okay.
And it's you not like bad. It? It's a good game. I mean, as far as racing games go, it's good.
It looks gorgeous, right?
It looks amazing. It looks super cool. Definitely. It's amazingly, beautifully looking.
Yeah.
Awesome. But it's not my type of game. I mean, the only racing game that I ever enjoyed was the Burnout series.
Yeah.
Which was very, very fun. But it was fun because it didn't really emphasize on the racing. It emphasized
it was more fun.
So that's what's fun about it. And that's why I loved it.
In terms of Forza, I think I'm more inclined towards Forza Horizon. For the Horizon series more than the Motorsport series. Because, I mean, these are very super serious races. I don't know. Like, maybe not really my thing.
Yeah.
Like, I'm a Mario Kart player, right?
Right.
There's nothing serious in Mario Kart.
Exactly, yeah.
So Forza Horizon is something that I may try eventually, but it's not a game or a series that brings me to the platform.
Right.
Really. Even, I mean, Halo does that better for me. Gears of War does that better for me.
Right.
Scalebound, man, that looks awesome. Quantum Break, Recore,
Sea of Thieves,
right, and anything that Rare makes except Kinect shit.
Yes, and Nuts and Bolts.
I liked Nuts and Bolts.
Really?
Yeah. I didn't love it, but I liked it.
But you liked it. Okay.
I think it was a fairly good game. I just think that it was a mistake to use the name Banjo-Kazooie in it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
because people were expecting something very different. But the game that's in there is actually good.
It's fun.
Yeah. It's cool. And the, I mean, getting a bit off topic here, right? But very quickly, all the vehicle construction mechanics in the Nuts and Bolts are phenomenally well done. Like, you can really go crazy and build some really crazy, like, stupidly crazy shit on the game and just drive that.
I remember doing lots of
inappropriate
vehicles.
Yeah. That was super fun.
Yeah.
Like, I remember doing some, like, really, by the end of the game, I remember I did some really freaking overpowered stuff.
Yeah.
Like a car that went so fast that it flied. I remember doing that.
Yeah, making the challenge work with vehicles that weren't meant for that challenge, but that you could somehow use them and get to where you needed to go. Yeah, I mean, it's a good game, but it's not a good Banjo-Kazooie game.
Yeah, it's not a Banjo-Kazooie game. Yes. Like, really, it's a very good game, but man, that wasn't what I was expecting. Wasn't, and still is not what I want out of the franchise. But I mean, yeah, get it off topic, right? But
Yes, absolutely right. Coming back to topic and to the Build conference, a couple weeks back, I think, we were talking about the Universal Windows platform, right? Tim Sweeney, the head of Epic Studios? He's the head, or is...
I don't know if he's the head, but yeah, he's a guy at Epic.
Long time Epic Games.
Long time, you know. And Epic Games, I mean, they have a big history with Microsoft, right?
Yeah.
They have like a long history.
The entirety of the Gears of War series. And Epic also worked on the Unreal Engine, which is...
And works on the Unreal Engine. They still develop the Unreal Engine. And a lot of the games that are made for this thing, for this platform called Xbox One,
somehow passed through Epic Games.
And are made with Unreal Engine.
Yes. Exactly. Which is an amazing engine, by the way.
Yeah.
It's in terms of programming, and I'm a programmer, of course, it's stunning. It's wow. C++. Anyway, but Phil responded to, someone else responded back then with a generic-ish answer, but Phil himself, the man, he responded to Tim, and he said, I think I have the quote here, you have to submit, I think this is the important part of the entirety of the quote. And I quote, you have to submit to our store if you're going to sell through our store, but you don't have to sell through our store. That's the main idea. And I think he, in a way, is right. What Tim was mad about was, worried about, was that, you know, they wanted to monopolize the developing scape of the Windows platforms, right? They wanted everyone to pass through those filters and then lose, in a way, some, you know, handling of their games and their properties, because they needed to, you know, give them in a way to Microsoft and then lose a little bit of the management on that side. But thing is, with this and, you know, the Universal Windows platform, and again, I don't want to sound like a Microsoft spokesman here, but they do have a point. I mean, the idea behind, you know, the Universal Windows platform is to create an ecosystem that's, you know, that englobes all of Windows 10 devices, which is the Xbox, PC, tablets, phones, the HoloLens. It's also part of Windows 10. And, you know, in order to do that, I understand that you have to have some policies and some restrictions in hand in order to, you know, maintain all of your assets and all of your things.
To keep a standard between your different platforms, definitely.
Of course. Yeah. In terms of both quality and just order, you know.
And logistics, definitely.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I think this is a very, again, I mentioned it last time, but I think it's a very foreign concept for gaming, but it's a very normal thing when it comes to software development and app development that you have, for instance, the Apple Store, right? The Apple Store won't allow you to upload whatever and then manage it any way you want it. You have to, you know, to concede, right? You have to meet them halfway and give them some, you know, some say into what you're showing in their store, because it's their store at the end of the day, and they need to control what you put in there. I think he actually, Phil mentioned, like, we cannot allow someone to rip Mario 64 and put it on the store as is, right? Because that wouldn't be right. So we need to put that in place. We need to put parental control, which, again, I'm not really in pro of. I'm not really an advocate for parental controls. I think parents should be a little more active in terms of how and right. the type of content their kids are allowed to see and to use. But I understand that the need for having parental controls in there, and also controls of all these things. You need to control the IPs, the properties, the intellectual properties, the rights of yeah. the whoever owns the intellectual property. And for that, I understand that it's got to be a little more restrictive than people are used to, developers are used to. And at the same time, I think that's pro-consumer. I think this is not really, think for the developer. It's more of a consumer thing. People that are going to visit the store are supposedly going to be having the best possible quality and quantity of products. And those products they know are going to be safe and are going to be good. And for that, in order to ensure that, the thing's got to be more restrictive.
It's a very difficult topic to discuss, absolutely. A super difficult thing to discuss, because it isn't something that has rolled out yet. It's something that is still, it's a set of new policies that still have to be put in effect, right? And I've seen both sides of the argument, yeah. And I can see both sides having a point, really.
Yeah, a valid point, definitely.
I don't know, to be totally honest with you, I don't really know what to say about this. It's difficult. I see Microsoft's point, and it makes a lot of sense. And I also see the point that many other developers have brought up, and I see what they're saying, right? I don't know. I also think that Phil Spencer is a man that is very guided towards a case-by-case basis. And I like that.
Right.
That's very good. But what will happen when he's no longer there, right? When his case-by-case basis, his case-by-case method of approaching every different developer and product is no longer in effect, when he's not there anymore. That will happen one day, right? And what will happen there? So I think I see why developers are concerned, but I also think that I also understand in some ways why Microsoft is doing this. And I think it's aggressive, definitely, on Microsoft's part. But that's competition. That's
right.
That's Steam needs a competition. Definitely, they need some of that. And
and Origin and
especially Steam, because Steam is.
Origin is not really making that possible. It's not really that competitive with Steam.
Yeah, save for GOG.
Right.
Good platforms and whatever, but Steam is basically almost a monopoly on PC, and they need. I think if there's someone that can take on Steam, that's Microsoft. Yes. And Microsoft has the manpower and the technology to do that.
The assets and resources.
And I'd like to see them doing stuff for competition. Do I trust them? I don't know. Microsoft has pulled up some weird shit in the past that I don't think I can fully trust them with that. But at the same time, I want to give them the benefit of the doubt, right? And I don't know. I think it's for me personally, it's a wait and see approach, and just waiting to see this program and these new policies rolling out and see how they affect.
Right.
How they affect the way that that apps and games and software will be distributed through the Windows stores in the future.
Definitely. Yes. Yeah. We'll have to wait and see. We'll have to wait up and see. Because, their dream for the future, for Microsoft's future, for the Windows 10 platform future, it's to have a single connected world, right? A single connected user interface that you can access through your phone, through your Xbox, through your PC, through everywhere, through your HoloLens. So in terms of dreaming, that's a cool idea. That's a very, the idealistic future everyone has in mind. It's, to wake up and then while brushing their teeth, they're checking their mail in their window under their mirror, and then on their car watching the news or whatever. For that to happen, this is sort of like a first step, if done right, if done ideally, if done utopically. But we'll have to wait and see. Innovation is a dangerous monster.
Yeah, I think this universal Windows platform is kind of similar in a sense to what Apple did with the App Store, right? Which they are sharing this ecosystem between macOS and iOS for iPhone and iPad. And I think these ideas for both Apple and Microsoft, they work phenomenally well when all of your devices are from the same company, like for I mean, if all of your devices are Windows 10 based, that's phenomenal. Or if all of your devices are Apple based, that works exceptionally well. I mean, if I have an Apple TV, like a MacBook, and an iPhone, and an iPad, like they communicate exceptionally well. Yeah. And the same for Windows. If I have a Windows phone and a Windows tablet and a PC and an Xbox One, I mean, they communicate very well. But like my, I don't know. Like I'm more worried about. I think this idea and this platform really suffers and breaks apart when that's not the case, when you don't have, when not all of your devices belong to this platform, right. which is kind of my case, right? Because for computers, I don't like Windows. I prefer Mac, but I want to own an Xbox One, so I may have this Windows 10 device on below my TV, but my computer is not a Windows thing. I don't like Windows on mobiles. Like I'm much of an Android guy, which also doesn't go with my Mac.
Right. Yeah.
So I do like these different OS for every different thing, and having them not communicate properly well between them because they're different OS, like kind of breaks the point.
Yeah.
In a sense.
Yeah, yeah.
Like I think it works exceptionally well, very good with people that are really pro Microsoft and everything Microsoft, or people that are really pro Apple, everything Apple, but like people that
I think really that's part of the argument, right? That's part of the point, right? If the thing works and it
works, they want to bring
great, that's exactly, what they want.
They want you to get all of your devices, all of your devices to be Windows 10 based.
Yeah.
But no, screw you, I don't want that. And same for Apple, I don't want everything to be iOS. Or,
yeah, this goes for everyone. This goes for Apple. This goes for even Android, right? Android has also you know, their tablet, their phones, their
there's Chrome OS, right?
Yes. Actually, Chrome and Google also has its own proprietary PCs and its own thing, Nexus and whatnot. So everyone wants a piece of the shared ecosystem.
Yeah.
But really, the big, really big names that are the ones capable to doing it so are Apple and Microsoft. I think
Google can eventually manage to do that. Yeah. I mean, not now, but long term, I think they can, because some of the services that they offer are exceptionally good. They're like very, very good. Yeah,
and universally loved too.
Yeah. Definitely.
Yeah, very interesting. Very, very cool. Let's move on, though, to our next topic, still Microsoft-related, still from that conference, but more positive this time around. Microsoft is finally, or Xbox is finally, delivering on the promise of a dev kit on every console.
This is super awesome.
Yes.
Like, this is super, super awesome. We both work at an indie dev studio.
Yes.
An indie game development studio. And we saw the news that they rolled out, and we were studying, we were like, oh my God, this is so awesome.
Yes.
Like, so awesome, because this makes things a lot easier for us in a sense.
You don't need to ask for a dev kit specifically to Microsoft. You can just buy a console, and that's it.
Yeah. You need to, if your game is like a very heavy in terms of requirements,
of course, yeah,
you need to, because the dev kit the Xbox One console, the retro console, will be able to function as a dev kit through an app, through like a download,
yes,
something that you can download on the, what's the name of the store, like the Windows store on the Xbox One. You can download the app and right there use your console as a dev kit, but it's very limited compared to the actual dev kit that you get from Microsoft. So it works very good for testing stuff and beginning, and if you want to begin doing stuff with the Xbox or maybe if you're publishing smaller games, I think this is all you need, definitely all you need. But if you want to publish bigger games that require more of the horsepower of the console, well, then you cannot. But at the same time, it's an excellent starting point for you as a developer to begin testing the waters with the platform, with the console, and begin putting stuff there. I think this is super awesome. Like, this is incredible. This is very, very good. I'm very excited about this. Yeah. And I think this is an aggressive move on Microsoft's part to get more developers
in
its competition with Sony. Yeah, I think this is great, awesome, love this.
It's a great way of leveling the field, because PS4 and Sony have, you see on the, you know, every week we check which games are coming out, right?
Yeah.
And it's a huge long of games which we filtered and then we show to you at the end of our show every week. But you see, a lot of those games are indie titles that are coming for the PS4. Yeah, yeah, PS4 and PC are just PS4 exclusives. And I think that's an amazing, you know, something that Sony made earlier on, being so friendly with indies, that pays off now. That it's paying off now, it's going to pay off in the future because everyone is developing for the PS4. So I think this was not just a good move, I think this was a necessary move from Microsoft in order to try and level the playing field for both big competitors in the console space. And I think it's good. I think it's a very cool thing. What I meant to say earlier was that, you know, this gives the potential to everyone really to start developing a game if they so want to and they decide to do so. It opens up the door for doing it, and that's cool.
And
that's
even nice. Even if indie, if these indie titles that may come now to the console are not like console sellers, because I mean they're
right. Yeah,
like, let's be real, they're not. But they support the brand, the Xbox brand, in many ways, and it's always a good thing to have them on your platform.
Absolutely.
And especially if you make it so easy for both sides, for both Microsoft and the developer side. If it's easy, it's very, very simple to just put the game out there on the Xbox One, both sides win in this one.
Completely agreed. Completely agreed.
Awesome.
So, yeah, let's see. Oh, it's coming this summer. It's coming.
Yeah, oh, yeah, right.
Following summer. Yes,
it's so soon.
On yeah, it is. And it's because of the first year anniversary of Windows 10. That's when the update's rolling out. And along with it, something very cool, too, that I find very, very futuristic and stuff. Cortana. Cortana is finally coming to Xbox. It's already on PCs, but it's finally coming to Xbox.
Oh, it's coming to Xbox One?
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
That's cool.
Yeah, very cool. Very. I want to see how it works, how it's implemented, and the capabilities of it in the console.
That's awesome.
What can it do? And
that's stuff. Great.
Yes. Yeah. Yes, very excited for that.
Now I can feel not alone.
Yeah. While playing. Hey, Cortana, tell me a joke or something. Talk to me.
Cortana, tell me your problems.
Let me tell you mine. But yeah, a very interesting thing coming this summer. Yeah. Stay tuned for that.
Not creepy at all.
Not at all. And finally, closing up and wrapping up this Microsoft heavy segment, something that I think is very important and very cool. We talked last week, about the PS4, about the PS4.5 or 4K, right? The new, we don't know, it's just rumors, but the allegedly new ish console or new more powerful console capable of running 4K gaming allegedly or maybe not, maybe we don't know, no one knows. And there were some rumors as well about Xbox doing something similar, Xbox doing upgradable hardware for your Xbox in order for you to have more horsepower. No one really knew what Phil mentioned it on a you know, I don't know what conference beforehand, and everyone was very confused, and he was approached about that and about Sony's move. And he said, let me quote here, "I'm not a big fan of Xbox One and a half. If we're going to move forward, I want to move forward in big numbers. I don't know anything about any of the rumors that are out there, but I can understand other teams' motivations to do that. For us, our box is doing well. It performs, it's reliable, the servers are doing well. If we're going to go forward with anything, like I said, I want it to be a really substantial change for people, an upgrade." Now for once, I'm very, very happy to hear that, because that means no Xbox 1.0, 1.2, 1.3, 1.5. That means no upgradable hardware, I hope. And that's good, because again, that's the magic of a console. That's the whole point of having a console, not needing to worry about, damn, my console right now cannot run any game that's coming out because it
that's
doesn't have
the
run.
That's the point of a console.
Exactly. You don't have to worry for half a decade at least.
Yeah.
And you can play every game, no matter if you have the ugliest, fungiest, fattest console, or if you have the newest and slimmest and with a cool design that just came out. You can still play the same games at the same frame rate, at the same resolution, and everyone's on the same level of, you know, of experience. You're not losing any experience. You're not losing the experience when you play the games because of some limitation. And that's good. That's great. I'm very, very happy for this. Very, very happy.
That gives me personally a lot of confidence in buying an Xbox One now. Especially because, I mean, he basically confirmed that, no, like, the Xbox One, as we know it, is here to stay until the next generation of consoles from us. And that's awesome. Yeah. Because that's the point of a console, right? And getting a piece of hardware, a box, and just not having to worry about it, and just getting to a store or Amazon or whatever, and just by looking at this brand, Xbox One, you know that my piece of plastic on the bottom of my TV can play it, and that's it.
Exactly.
Like, when I buy, for instance, using this controller for an example, when I buy this, I just look at this and I know it works with the Xbox One. I don't have to look on the back and look at any tech specifications and look if my machine can support it. I don't, as a console gamer, I don't want to do that.
Yeah.
Like, if you PC guys, like, welcome to the PC gaming, well, good for you. This is not PC gaming, right? And if you have the time and the energy and want to do that, like, good for you. But that's not the case for console gamers.
Yeah.
There are many people that are busy and want to spend time with other stuff and just want to sit and just want to play and just play. Like there are many people like me, we just want to get home and get a controller and play. Like, we don't want to spend hours just trying to get a thing playing or running. And that's the point of a console, right?
Yes. Yes. Not that there's anything wrong with that, right? That's a very cool, you know, system, having your upgrades and having...
Yeah, but different audiences. Those are for different
people. It's made for different type of gaming, of gamers. And not necessarily different types of gaming, of gamers, but...
Different lifestyles.
Yes, exactly. Some people, like us, appreciate the convenience of just being ready to play whenever it's ready and not worrying about if it's going to run, if I had to take the textures down, if I have to lower the resolution. And, I mean, I'm a PC gamer, too. I'm like, in the middle, right? And I do game on my PC. But I really enjoy having that on my console. On my console, I don't have to worry about any of that. Whenever I play on my PC, I might need to worry about a couple things.
Yeah.
And it's a very different experience, and it's a very different type of games that you can play on your PC. And that's what I love about it, the variety. But, you know, for console, when I'm playing on my console, I just like being able to play the same game with everyone else and everyone playing on the same exact resolution, frame rate, level playing field. And that's the magic of it.
Pretty sure it was. Yeah, it was 2 weeks ago. I was trying to play the game that we're working on at the studio, at our game development studio. And
check it out. It's on the description of last week's.
And will be on this one as well.
Yes.
And I was trying to play that on a PC, of course, because it's a PC game. And I remember that I couldn't get the driver from the controller to work.
Right.
And like, I spent at least like a half an hour like looking on the internet, like what's going on. And that's something like this. That troubleshooting is not something that you find on a console. Like, you always get the controller to work like this quickly.
Exactly.
And that's, I know, like, that's not what I want to in my gaming experience. Like, I know that people don't have a problem with that, and I know that people make it malign because I did something wrong. I'm stupid, and I don't have a life. I know, right? But I don't want. Dad, every time I play, like, I just want to get to my home and know that I will be able to play perfectly fine without any problems. And that's not always the case for PC. Even the most hardcore like passionate PC gamers, like, man, like, you are allowed to love your PC, and like, you're allowed to claim that is the best thing ever, right? I mean, you're entitled to your own opinion, but you can't deny the fact that you spend time troubleshooting your PC. Like, you spend time looking on later because stuff doesn't work always.
Yeah.
You spend time doing that, and that's the fact. That's just something that happens. And I don't want that. I don't want that out of my experience. And I'm happy to see that the Xbox is not going that way.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, it has its advantages, right? Because you get more powerful hardware, better graphics, and whatever. But you also get some disadvantages. And for some people, the advantages weigh more than the disadvantages. But some other people, it's otherwise. And that's my case.
Yeah.
That's definitely my case.
Yeah, I agree. And actually, on top, now that you mentioned disadvantages, not just for the consumer, but also for the developer, because now developers are going to need to worry about, well, some people have the vanilla version of the Xbox, some other people have the upgraded version, and now I need to take that into account and have that in mind when I'm developing my game. And that's not always, part of the convenience also for the developer side.
That makes marketing decisions way more difficult for all sides.
Yeah, definitely. So yeah, very happy that Phil, that's why we love you, man. Those are the good decisions that have you in your position right now, because you're good at it. You're really good at it.
Yeah, Phil, come to the show.
Yeah, yeah. Fly down to Mexico.
Yeah, we can go if you want to. Like, no problem.
That'll be great. And yeah, that's our wrapping up of the Microsoft heavy section. Yeah.